you know, we've launched brands that have completely, you know, we've lost $250,000, $500,000, and it just went away, right? And I think it's not everything's going to be a winner, right? And it's okay.
Welcome to Clicks and Bricks Podcast. We talk about the entrepreneur mindset.
If you get one shot at this, what kind of shot are you going to take?
If we forget who we are, they're going to forget who you are.
And you've got an adversity story that's out of this world.
Everything from that Main Street brick and mortar to that billion-dollar manufacturer.
So I was in the engineer. So it was funny. There's a business school entrepreneurship program or club. Right. And then there was an engineering school entrepreneurship club. I didn't join the business one because I was like, why do I need more Bryans? I need engineers. I need people with skills, right? And so I actually joined the engineering entrepreneurship club as opposed to the business one. And that landed me because I wanted to, you know, 2015, 2014, 2013 was apps. So I was like, okay, we're going to develop an app. We're going to go famous, right? All that, right? And so I think, yeah, joining, you know, the fraternity, I'm more of an, as much as I love sales and I'm out there and I'm charismatic, I'm an introvert. I like doing my own thing. I like, you know, hanging out, you know, smoking a little cannabis and just chilling, right? I don't do the parties, the festivals, the clubs, all right. That type of stuff. And so for me, actually my random college roommate, RJ, who's one of the other business partners, you know, after about like living with him for about 3 weeks, you know, we really hit it off in this entrepreneurial path. And so him and I were just kind of like bouncing ideas back and forth. And so like one of the ideas we had was this company called TV Threads, which was basically you're watching a, you know, a movie or a TV show. And let's say you're watching, you know, Entourage and, you know, you like the suit that Jeremy Piven's wearing, you know, right. Where can you find the, what brand is it? How much does it cost? All of that. Right. And so I pitched it to RJ and he's like, this is awesome. Of course I watch TV all the time. I want to know what's going on. And even the home decor and the scenes, all of that could have been incorporated. Right. And so pretty viable idea, a ton of information gathering, but viable. Right. So I said, he goes, how much money are you going to need? And I said, I think we're going to need $1,200 for an MVP. Within 2 hours, I had $1,200 in my bank account ready to go. And I said, okay, that's my business partner for life.
Yes.
Right. And so this networking effect that I had going to GW, I mean, I wouldn't be here today without it. And so I think in terms of the education footprint, we all know the school's a game. You go to class, you study the book, you take the test, you get a good grade, they let you leave. Right. They don't, what I want to know is why doesn't the business school give you a project to go make a dollar? Go make a dollar.
Right.
It's not there.
That's business school, right?
Exactly.
You've mentioned this a couple times. I need an engineer or I need an investor. I need the money. At what age did you realize to really scale that you needed to have skill sets from other people that you didn't have inherently in yourself?
Yeah. So kind of touching back to the degrees. So accounting, I use every day. I read all of our financial statements. It has been a valuable skill as we've scaled up. And I think being able to talk on not just kind of like a street level, but on a corporate level to, right. You know, we've raised venture capital funds. And so I think that was a big proponent. And I think in terms of the early days for setting up the website and doing digital marketing, kind of teaching myself all that, the information systems degree was like more of like the techie side of me. And I just kind of figured it out. Right. But I think, you know, in terms of your question specifically, like I never wanted to master Photoshop. I never wanted to master programming. Right. I never wanted to be a one kind of trick pony. Right. And I think that's why I've always looked for other people with skill sets that can help me. And I think that's a really big, kind of pain point for early entrepreneurs where they have these ideas in their head and they're like, I can't tell anybody, they're going to steal my ideas. It's going to be horrible. And I'm going to go sue them and all of this. I learned really early on, if you want your idea to come to life, you need to tell everybody.
Yes.
Right. And you need to tell your closest circle. Right. And you start getting different perspective. You start getting different ideas floating around and people with different skill sets can add different value in different areas. And if you keep it all to yourself, it's just going to be you in a room alone. Right. And so, you know, opening up, sharing with RJ originally the idea and then us deciding, okay, cool, we need this type of skill set. We need that. And I think that kind of goes back to the kind of five levels of like leadership. You know, first you're like an expert leader, right? You need to market your product, right? Or find product market fix. Then you're a systems leader. You got to create processes and systems to bring in good talent, right? And then, you know, you kind of go through these leadership stages. And I think honestly, it's intuition, a lot of this, right? This is my first rodeo at this magnitude. Yes, I've had some smaller entrepreneurial success, but this has changed the game for me, right? You know, we're
in a totally different number.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's a pretty big number.
Yeah, so I think that just goes back to identifying, like, you need good people around you. And, you know, being able to identify talent is a skill set of a good leader, right? Like, if you keep hiring poor people, you're just gonna not move, right? And I, you know, in different businesses have different, you know, life cycles, right? And so, you know, we're the, you know, culture disruptor, you know, VC back funded, you know, we have a 5 to 7 year life cycle that our investors want to exit out on. And so I think it's a little bit different path, right? And then you've got cash flow businesses and all different types of approaches to this world. But yeah, for us, it's, you know, this has definitely been an unreal journey under, you know, just seeing all the different aspects.
Yeah, it's wonderful. But, yeah. And I'm super excited that you've been able to do that, maintain your health, grow to these levels. It's challenging. There's lots of stress, lots of worries, lots of things on your plate that a lot of people that have not ever been there, and I've not scaled to 100 million yet, but that they don't understand. Like,
right.
Like, a lot of people will never understand waking up in the morning saying, I need $100,000 before the end of the day, or I'm probably out of business and I don't know where I'm going to get it. Right. And then you figure that out by 3 o'clock in the afternoon, somehow magically happens. But a lot of people don't understand that and they never will. So congratulations for getting to where you are and maintaining health and happy attitude and not only creating great products, but helping the world by getting rid of some of these sweatshops. I think that's something that you should talk about more, for sure.
For sure.
Now, back to the business side. When you're doing these businesses and you're an entrepreneur and you've obviously got a ton of really great ideas, and I think this is a plague for a lot of entrepreneurs and a lot of business owners and starters, how do you know which ones to execute on and which ones to just let die off to the side?
For sure. So I've gotten better at this, I think.
Congratulations.
You know, we've launched brands that have completely, you know, we've lost $250,000, $500,000, and it just went away, right? And I think it's not everything's going to be a winner, right? And it's okay, right? You know, early on when you're starting something, you're fighting to the death, you know, every Instagram post, every customer service request, everything, you know, every little approach that you're trying to be perfect at. And I think for me specifically on this journey, you know, how to identify, you know, whether it's a product in your business or a whole segment or in a business, I think you can kind of map it out, actually, you know, and I love using Excel. And I think mapping out the product life cycle, right? Or the brand life cycle, what does this brand look like on day one? And what does it look like on day, you know, 1,000, right? And what does it look like on day 2,000, right? And identifying the transition periods, the, you know, where the innovation is coming from and how to scale it up with a sales model. So it's kind of a two-pronged approach. You could have a great product. You could have a just as equally shittier product right next to it. But if that company's marketing more than you or better than you, they'll win every time, right? And I think that's something to really recognize. It's like, not everything has to be perfect. It doesn't have to be an Apple commercial every time you put a piece of content out. It doesn't have to be, you know, an iPhone product every time you release a new product, right? So I think it's, you know, being honest with yourself, right? Like, I think everyone gets a little bit overzealous with some things, you know, oh, I have this awesome idea, this awesome product, we're going to sell millions. That doesn't always happen. And it really does happen, right? And I think being realistic, and I think honestly, getting back to a little bit of just self-awareness, right? Like, you know, everyone sits in a little bubble. Everyone's got their own ideas for what success looks like. And I think that if you just take a step back, look at everything from a holistic perspective and identify like is this truly going to happen? Is this truly viable? And you just kind of build out the model, right? And that's how I think you can identify whether something's going to be a winner or not. And you can really, like, I know a lot of people, you know, my buddies in entrepreneurship, they craft out these businesses and say, okay, after 5 years, who are our acquirers? Oh, if we're doing food, it's Mandela's. If we're doing automation, it's Salesforce. If we're doing SaaS, it's Salesforce. If we're doing, you know, it's, you have to identify these people because your investors want an exit. And if it's a cash flow business, you know, God bless you. Awesome. Take as much as you can, as long as the business can keep running, right? And I think it's all these different approaches, you know, whether it's a cash flow business, whether it's a, you know, raise money, get acquired, you know, hit certain benchmarks. I think it really just depends on what you're trying to do, right? And honestly, what kind of stress levels you can handle, right? There's a lot of dark times, more dark times than roses, you know?
Yes, and absolutely.
I think it's depending on the path you choose, there's going to be more dark times than roses or vice versa, right?
Right. 20 years ago, we started a hosting company, and the sole purpose of that hosting company was to give us stable jobs for the rest of our lives, right? That's... And then, and a playground to do our other shenanigans that we wanna launch out of, right? That's the entire purpose for our entire hosting company, is stable income and high upside to try these different little programs through. So I think it's phenomenal what you've done, and congratulations for all the big hits that you've had. We're wrapping into an hour here, Bryan. If somebody's out there and they have an idea and they want to give it a shot, but they for some reason can't get off the fence, and you've went into not the most risky business in the world, right? I mean, there's definitely more risky businesses that you could have gone into, but you went into a fairly risky business. What do you tell that person to overcome, or do you tell them, hey, if you can't handle it, don't do it? Like, do you tell them, hey, this is what you need to do to overcome it, or you know what, just sit on the bench, man, and that this isn't for you?
Right. I think a lot of people, you know, especially in the past 5-10 years, you know, this word entrepreneurship has just been thrown around like it's a career path that you can just decide one day. Right. And I think a lot of people, you know, don't realize that they are the one trick pony, right? They're really good at programming, or they're really good at marketing, or they're really good at, you know, developing UI UX experiences. Right. And those types of people need to find good companies that can support those skill sets, right? In terms of entrepreneurship, I think a lot of people are their biggest enemy, and they're afraid to just start, right? They're perfectionists. They want everything to be 100% before they can go. I'm telling you, the website was not 100%. I didn't know diddly squat about, you know, am I curating the right box for people? I mean, I like it. Do they like it? I didn't really care.
Right.
I just graduated. I need to make money. We're going. We're selling, right?
Right.
And so I think that's like a big thing for people to really, again, back to that kind of self-awareness. It's like, do I truly want to be the leader? Do I want to be 17, 18 hour days for 5 years straight to get to the roses? Right.
5 years.
Right. And oftentimes people just don't want the stress. They want to turn it off when they get home. For me, I love it. I love waking up, coming into the work, you know, my guys, everyone in the office, everyone's just jazzed up. We're excited. We're solving problems. We're scaling businesses. And, you know, I think once the money starts flowing in and everyone starts getting paid, I think it obviously gets a lot more exciting, but you don't get to that point day one, and you don't get to that point day 1,000. Right. And so I think the big message to take away is just start, put out an MVP, get feedback, get more feedback, reiterate, fail fast, keep doing that until you get the winner.
Yes. And you brought up another question for me. When the money starts coming in, people are getting paid, you don't have those worries anymore. I've seen a lot of business owners, and I'll raise my hand here, I'm guilty of the same thing, of saying, we made it, and relaxing a little too much, right? How do you, when you get there and you're like, oh my gosh, we're here, we're profitable, we're growing, how do you keep that fire burning bright to keep going down this path? Because I know for me, it's like, ooh, I did it. Let's do the next thing. Right.
Right. This is actually a great question. I actually caught myself in this probably the last 6 months. So I closed the largest deal of my life back in September of last year, about $30 million contract. And thank you. And you know, we basically celebrated with Chick-fil-A in the office, right? And I, at that point, you know, I'm talking to RJ, and, you know, RJ's like, dude, you could probably go home for like 6 months and it's all good, right? Not do anything. And I didn't go home for 6 months, but I definitely did not do the 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 hour days anymore, right? I wasn't as hungry, right? And because, you know, you get that safety net, right? Well, okay, cool. We'll have enough cash flow for 2 years at that point, right? And so I actually just caught myself recently where I wasn't reaching out to new customers as much. I wasn't contacting new prospects. I wasn't really working on a lot of things that I had backburned, you know, that needed to get done, right? And so actually recently I just kind of started kicking it into, you know, we call it beast mode again. And, you know, and I think it's a good thing for, you know, a lot of the, you know, close circle that we have here, you know, like some of the guys, they come in, you know, if they don't see me, they're discouraged, right? And I don't want that. You know, I want them to know I'm fighting on the front lines with them every single day, right? And so I 100% just caught myself in this exact thing. And I think it's definitely something to be cognizant about, and totally getting back to that self-awareness thing. Am I being lazy? Can I do more? Am I not doing enough? Right. What does the business need, right? And I think always putting the business needs before your own will always garner success at the end of the day.
I 100% agree with you. And congratulations for having the self-awareness to get there through even at your young age. And if you don't have it, you have to have a mentor or a coach, somebody that can tell you, dude, you got to get back off your ass and get back out there and go for it, right?
For sure. We have a great support system here. And I think, you know, with the business partners, we all kind of check each other and hold each other accountable.
Right.
And I think you need that. And I think it's, you know, founder turmoil is a big thing that crushes companies as well. And I think it's picking your partners wisely and picking the closest next, you know, totem poles in your business, right? The support beams, right? Your director levels, your C-suite level people, right? Like making sure everybody is moving in the right direction and everyone's goals are aligned, right? And I think that's how you garner success.
Wonderful. Bryan, thank you so much for your time today. I appreciate it. I've had a blast talking with you. If somebody wanted to buy your product, how would they find it again?
So you can buy all the smoking accessory stuff off hemper.com. That's H-E-M-P-E-R.com. And if you're looking for pre-rolled cones, that would be harasupply.com, H-A-R-A, supply.com. And if you want to reach out to me personally, Bryan, B-R-Y-A-N, at hemper.com.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. I hope to get to talk to you again soon.
Thank you so much for having me.
That's it for today's show, folks. If you'd like to join my text line community, the number is 314-370-2871. All you have to do to join that text line is send me any question about business or technology. I'll do all the research and I'll give you an absolutely free, totally unbiased answer. Get to work.